All right, everybody, welcome back to the chaos. That is my garage. Actually, this was is a lot cleaner than it was a few days ago. I've just had spare parts bins dumped everywhere because I am at the fitment phase on this bike. I've spent a number of hours behind the scenes here, not filming, just getting things kind of on and ready. Let me walk you through some of these things. So I guess I'll start right here on the grips. This bike came with a plastic throttle, which I hated. So I managed to find this old BT&E in my spares. And so I spent some time kind of rebuilding it and cleaning it up. Found these grips in my spares. I'm reusing the throttle cable that came with the bike. I've got a brand new universal brake cable. And I'm also reusing the clutch cable that was on this bike because it seemed good enough. I mean, in a perfect world, I'd spend another $100 on cables, but that seems unnecessary. Also, the levers were mismatched and actually incorrect, so I went through my spares and found a nice pair of matching levers. I've spent quite a bit of time getting the exhaust fitment just right. I had to have the oil tank in to make sure it didn't hit. Found these spacers at the hardware store, so they seem to fit pretty good. They seem to be just where I want them. The brake pedal took me a little time to figure out. So the pedal that was on this bike was this pedal, which I think is a slightly tweaked 650 brake pedal. It had this perch on it. This is like I think 63 and 64 only. So what I've done is I put on a pre-unit perch and just a little spacer to bring it just where I needed to. This is the brake pedal that was on my 64 T100C, that bike over there. And it's actually correct for the 68, which is interesting, because I just happen to have a spare brake lever or brake pedal that is correct for the T100SC. So it's a little different. There's a little stop right here that gets installed right here. On the 64, it doesn't have that. It actually rests right against the frame rail. So it was missing the stop. I pulled it off my other 68 back there. So that gets installed in here, like that. If I was feeling a little bit more jaunty, I would actually just modify this little piece I had in my spare parts to act like a perch. But this is a quick and easy way to just steal from other bikes. Also, these are the original foot pegs that were on the bike, and they are interesting to say the least. These are stock folding style T100C pegs. They're not as strong, that's for sure, but they look better. So I think I'm probably going to just run these for now. I stole those from my 64 as well. So I'm also trying to set up the Electrics World kit here and try to figure out where I want everything. I think I want the coil hidden between my tank right here. I'll probably just hold it in with zip ties. That way the spark plug cable kind of points backwards like this. I'll trim it up. I'm going to mount the module. Where is it at? This module. Right here. I'm going to make a little bracket off my oil tank to mount it to. And I'll probably have to lengthen a couple wires. But otherwise, everything looks like it fits just right. I got some basic dims of the thing I'm going to make. So I guess I'm going to do that right now. I'm making this out of 14 gauge. I probably could have gone with 16 gauge. This feels maybe a tad heavier than I really need, but it's fine. Also went ahead and drilled a hole at all my inside corners to make cutting that out a little easier. All right, first fitment. Perfect. So I'm going to bend that tab inwards to meet the oil tank and then up to kind of give it a flat surface so it can't really rotate. Very hard to do with one hand. All right. That little stop right there rests up against the oil tank. And this is going to let me mount my module right here. I'll probably do a little weld on one side and then a couple through holes here to put a zip tie through to hold it up right there. All right, I'm going to do a little metal finishing and give it some rounded corners and call it good for now until it's time to mount that module. All right, I'm not going to go super crazy metal finish with this, especially since I'm going to paint it. But there we go. Okay, you can kind of see what I've done. Mounted it through the screw hole there. And then just drilled a hole right there to hold with the zip tie. And that's what it looks like all mounted together. After I paint this, I'm going to add a little felt pad to the back of that landing that touches the oil tank just so it doesn't shake apart anything. This goes up to the coil. It'll just follow along up there. And this will go to the kill switch, which I usually like to mount back here for my right hand to swing down and hit. So that'll just kind of come around like that. I've got the wiring to the control module all hooked up. I'm going to add another little clip right here to kind of hold this wire there. So now I need to extend the wire to the coils. All right, I find wiring on the bike extremely difficult. So I took everything off. Because it doesn't matter what plug these go into, I'm just going to use black wire for both. So what I do is I fray the ends. And I push them together and twist them up, add some flux, and then I solder. I'm not the best at soldering, but I think you get the idea. So now I'll just clean up all this wiring. Let's see if we've got spark. Lots of spark. Alright, I think I'm at the phase where I need to start doing some plumbing here, and that means I need to pull that oil tank out and clean it up. Alright, well, I've got the oil tank off. Let's do a little deep dive into oil tanks. So, in 1959, the 500s became unit construction, and they used the same oil tank from 59 through 63. And they look just like this one, except there's a little tab down here with two little holes that held it onto the frame. The 64 and 65 tank looks like this. It's got the mount on the bottom there like that. The rockers get fed from the bottom T section down there. And it's got a froth tower at the top right there. 66 and 67 are drastically different. They went to a rubber mounted insert up here. Instead of just a rubber washer. Also, for some reason, they moved the rocker feed to the top. It's no longer on the bottom. In 68, it looks a lot like a 66 or 67 tank, same mounts at the top. Except now, they moved the rocker feed back to the bottom. This was actually the tank that was on this bike, which is incorrect. It should be this one. And then 1970, it looks just like this, except they got rid of that little spigot right there for the chain oiler. So when it's a top-fed rocker like this, you need like a short little rocker feed like this. when it's a bottom fed rocker, you need the long cable to reach all the way down. So because this is the correct oil tank for my 67, I'm going to clean this one out, and it's already painted, so one less thing I have to do. The chain oilers can be completely turned off by turning that screw all the way clockwise, which is what I'm going to do. I'll just block it off and not use it. Got the oil tank all cleaned up. I used a mixture of old gas and some screws and shook it around for a whole bunch. Cleaned it all out. And then took it in my parts washer and cleaned it out some more and blew it out. I probably should have done a pressure test, but I feel pretty good about this tank. All the parts and pieces are all nice and clean. I've got new top rubber mounts. I've got a new bottom rubber mount. I've got a new gasket or fiber washer for the screen. And I didn't have the fiber washer for the drain. I'm going to double up two copper washers. I've already annealed them. I think it'll probably actually be just fine. I guess I'll find out. And I've got a new cork gasket for the oil tank, but the oil tank gasket is actually pretty decent too. By the way, none of these are in the engine gasket kit, so I was lucky enough to hunt through my spares and find them all. All right, let me get this oil tank reassembled. All right, I've got the rocker feed all hooked up to the oil tank here. I've got the chain oiler blocked off and shut off inside. I've got the primary breather and the froth tower hooked up. This is fairly similar to stock. It kind of comes down here, T's, and then the drain kind of loops over and goes down the down tube underneath the bike. I've also got the kill switch hooked up. So this was originally on the bars, but I like it over here. So it's going to hook to the module there, and then I just need to hook up to a ground, and so it just grounds itself out. It's just about ready for oil. I still need to do the lines on the bottom, but I have something coming in the mail. Hey, hey, hey. Look what I got. I spent my paper route money on it. Okay, the Morgo is not like a necessary upgrade, but it's a little thing I like to splurge on. If you have a good working stock pump, it's totally fine. But I've had a few bad instances of luck with stock pumps, so I always try to upgrade it to the Morgo. They're kind of hard to get sometimes. As you can see, some of these numbers, the return pistons are practically the same, 0.484 and 0.488. It's the feed line that's bigger. So on this one, it's a 0.374, so about 3/8. And on this one, it's 0.414. I'm not sure what that comes out to fraction. I think they're even smaller on pre-units. And at some point in the 70s, I think they became pretty comparable to the Morgo pump. I don't know all that factual information. But needless to say, it's one of the things I like to splurge on. So what I'm going to do is clean this all up and preload it with some oil. Okay, I'm going to be using 2050 VR1. So I'm just going to throw some in this little dish. I've cleaned up the plungers, so I'm going to put them back in. So this thing is pretty much just plug and play. This is just for my own peace of mind. They have very close tolerances. So we're going to start pulling some oil through here. And that should be plenty good. So I'll clean up this mating surface right here. All right, like I said, this thing is pretty much plug and play. I've gone ahead and oiled up the little oil block here, plunger block, whatever you want to call this thing. Got the new gasket that Morgo supplies. Seems like it's decent quality. If I can open it up. Okay, goes on like this, the little slot right there. I don't think I really need to use any Hylamar or anything on this because it is an enclosed system over here. Okay. I'm going to wipe down this surface one more time. And it's just simply putting it on and getting it over that block. Come on, Jason, you can do this. I'm telling you, it's really close tolerances. Definitely has strong suction. There we go. Yeesh. Okay, we take our stock washers, and the nuts on these are domed. Dome goes in. Not over tighten. Okay, I think that's pretty good. Give her a little test. Oh yeah, here it comes, sucking in. I'm not gonna do too much, it's gonna just start sucking in dry. So now I need to put on the oil lines, the feed and return down here underneath the oil tank, then I can fill the tank up with oil. Next I'm going to add about 4 ounces of oil into that hole right there to kind of preload the sump so it doesn't just have a dry sump on startup. All right, next I'm going to connect the feed to the motor feed and the return to the motor return. The way to remember it is feed, which has the filter on it, feed front. So you look for the front pipe going in. Connect those two together. Front feed and rear return. All right, next I'm going to put about 2.5 quarts of this Valvoline VR1 2050 in. This is a perfectly fine oil to put in, and it's really easy to get. But if I was babying this bike and I was really treating it good, I'd be using Pengrade. So this normally goes in some of my other bikes. But while we're talking about this, I no longer use this in my primary for my clutch. If you read the specifications on this, it says not to use it for a clutch. So I for sure use my Pengrade in there. This is kind of a more of an enclosed system, so what you need to do is remove that little drain plug right underneath the pressure release valve. And you can check and make sure you have oil flow. Looks like we're good. All right, I think I changed my mind. I'm not going to use Loctite 518 here. I am going to go ahead and use a gasket. I know it didn't have a gasket from the factory, but I don't really see anything that it's going to affect tolerance-wise. And I do like the convenience of having a gasket, so I'm going to go ahead and use it. I went ahead and sprayed it down with Hylamar. I just think it makes taking covers off a little bit easier. So I'm going to stick with it. Little mosquito wants to be trapped in there. So there are three longer screws, and they go here, here, and here, I think. They usually go on the bottom. Not sure why this wouldn't be a longer screw, but it doesn't appear to be. All right, I'm gonna do a star pattern. All right, next I'm gonna add the gearbox oil. Finally, I've built this gearbox a long time ago, so it's kind of nice to finally put the oil in. Remove this cap. It's got a fresh O-ring on it. That's where we're gonna put the oil. On the underside is the oil drain and overflow tube. So what you wanna do is just remove that smaller bolt in the center there and add oil, and once it reaches the appropriate level, it'll start coming out there. So I'm using the good stuff, pen grade 80 weight 90. Oh, here we go. Starting to drizzle out right there. I'll let that sit for a second before I put the screw back in. Okay, oil in the oil tank, oil in the gearbox, timing cover back on. Time to get that exhaust back on, and then I'm going to adjust the clutch really quick. Hey, you want to be in the film? You can have your ears plugged if you want. You sit right here. All right. That'd be funny. All right. Well, that was really great. I mean, it started right up. It was a little smoky. I'm going to re-torque the head, redo the valves. I'm going to do another compression check just to make sure I'm not getting any oil through those rings. When I did this before I took the top end off, I was getting like 150 PSI, but I just want to double check, so I'll do it now. Finally time to strobe time this thing, and I probably have the cheapest timing light ever created, but that's okay. My inductive clamp is not even marked to say which direction the spark plug goes, so I just put it on like that. I have an external battery. It needs to be 12 volt, so I have that hooked up to the strobe, and then I have all my wires like delicately avoiding this really hot exhaust pipe. Now, both of these plug cables fire at the same time. So in theory, I didn't think there would be a number one lead. I tried it on this lead, and once I just about hit full advance, the strobe would turn off. So make sure you have it on. If it's not working on one, try it on the other one. Okay? So let's give this a shot. What we're going to do is use the factory setting right there. And we're going to test it against the factory setting right there. That's where it wants to be. All right, I'm putting on my earmuffs here. Okay, right now, the timing is going to be retarded. Go to full advance at around 2,500 or 3,000 RPM. We're like almost right on the money. I don't even think it's worth changing. So that's pretty good. I mean, I just static timed that and I basically ran on the money. You can't ask for better than that. So now that everything's been adjusted on the valves and retorqued a number of times, our timing is good. We can actually finish this bike up and then dedicate a little bit of time to getting the jetting just right. Onto this gas tank. So I think it's actually in really good shape. It's probably hard to see, but there's just some very light surface rust in there. So I don't even think I really need to clean it out. I'm going to fill it up with some vinegar and let it sit for a day or two and see how much that cleans out. Okay, I've had this gas tank sitting with vinegar in it for, I don't know, 5 days, and I really don't think much has happened. I think one of the problems is the vinegar I was able to get was just too low of ratio, but I'm gonna dump this out and see what we're looking with.
Okay,
I've done a better job than I thought. Pretty goopy. Pretty dark. I don't know how well you're going to be able to see this, but it actually looks relatively decent in there. But there's real clean spots down there. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to rinse it out with water, blow it out, and then I'm going to do a secondary wash with some gas and some sheet metal screws and just kind of get it one more time before I seal it up. Well, I shouldn't say seal it up. I'm not using any sort of sealer. Wow, just rinsing it out with water, I got a heck of a lot more sediment out. There's a lot in there. All right, I just did a gas and sheet metal screw shake, and it's looking really good in there. I don't know if you can really see it, but it looks good. I did notice it looks like there might be a little bit of a Bondo or some sort of fuel sealant repair right there. Hopefully that doesn't come back to haunt me, but this tank did not leak, so we'll see how this runs. I dumped some Marvel's Mystery Oil in there just to kind of coat everything, keep it from flash rusting even after the gasoline. It won't do anything to your gas, so it's no reason not to do it. I also filtered out all my vinegar because this stuff used to be cheap, but not anymore. Wow, looky there. It's actually raining here. Anyway, so I've got my nice cleaned out tank. I've got some brand new petcocks. Now, these petcocks are the Taiwan versions. I used to use the made in UK versions. See if I can talk over this thunder. I used to use the UK versions, but they use a rubber O-ring that swells up with the ethanol, and they always leak. So I switched to these Taiwan versions. They use the like the tapered brass insert version, and they're cheaper, and I think they work better. So I've switched over to using the Taiwan petcocks. Got a new set of rubber. I've got my new petcock washers, and then I've got all the parts and pieces. So this bike came with stud adapters. So on a stock bike, this is going to be a bolt that goes on the underside. But these have been upgraded. I don't even know if they make these anymore. They're a stud that screws in. I'll probably use red Loctite. And then they have a lock nut on the end, which to me makes that seem like it would pull out of the tank a little easier, but I guess we'll see what it's like. Anyway, I'm gonna install all this stuff and get it on the tank. I've gone ahead and wired the kill switch, so it just connects to the kill on the module and then it hits a ground. This was the original kill switch that killed the ET ignition. Originally it was on the handlebars, so I like to put them right here. Easy access with the right hand. I did the same thing on my 55. Alright, looky there. This is the very first time this tank has ever been properly mounted, not just sitting up there. So that's pretty cool. Now I'm going to trim up these spark plug wires a little bit. I took a whopping 5 inches off. I also add the rubber boots on each end. Keep them nice and waterproof. Getting close. Even though I'm going to make an air filter, I decided to go ahead and put on the stock one, and I put in a new air filter element inside. Now it's just time to put on the primary cover. So I decided that I am going to use the gasket. I'm going to lightly cover this in grease, plop it on. I've got new washers and O-rings and everything for all the different little plugs. This should go together real quick. I almost forgot about the wire exit there. Because I'm not using the grommet, I plugged it up with some Loctite 518. I believe that'll hold. Find out. Alright, I've got the gasket on and the primary cover on, just kind of loosely at the top up here. So when you put it on, you need to kind of slide it up over that little bolt on the end of the adjuster. And then you add this threaded adjuster afterwards. Now, my primary chain is already pretty much perfect without being tight. So I'm just going to get it on just enough so there's tension, but I'm not going to tighten up the chain anymore. All right, she's all buttoned up. Now, to check your primary chain normally, you need to put your finger down here. And you lift up and down on the chain, which is a horrible method. But as long as you've got a little bit of slack in there, you should feel like you're okay. It's hard to measure that. Maybe you can make a special tool, but you can just kind of get a feel for it. I'm just going to put a very small amount of straight 40 weight pen grade in there. I think a lot of guys run ATF. I don't like ATF. 40 weight might be a little bit heavy for it, but in the hot climate I'm in, it should be fine. You just want a little bit. It's just to basically coat the bottom of the chain in there. So less is better than more. I'll probably put like 150 milliliters or something in there.
Thank you, miss.
All right, that was a pretty successful first test ride. So I've already had to make a few adjustments. This kickstarter lever, it was bent a little bit, and every time I'd kick it, my foot would hit this foot peg and it really hurt. So I kind of tweaked it a little bit and got it at the right position. Also, when it was closed, it would hit the exhaust, so I added a little weld bead right there on the end to keep it from rotating any farther. I adjusted this shift arm to be a little bit more out. I think it works a little bit better. These bars, they're cool, but I don't know if they're right for me. If in a comfortable riding position, they have to be back a little bit more, and it feels like they're right in your belly. And then when you stand up, they're too far back. So if you push the bars forward like this, your arm, your wrists are kind of at a weird angle holding on. So, I mean, I think they'd be really good for like riding on road, because you're not standing a lot. But for off-road, I think I'm going to switch to something a little bit more comfortable and more familiar. Just kind of a more standard motocross bar. But otherwise, this thing sounds freaking fantastic. Off think that just about does her. This baby has been running for a couple weeks. I've taken it on a couple test rides. And as of this recording, it is 1 week away from Biltwell 100 in Ridgecrest. So I think I'm going to take this bike. I've already built a nice new bash plate for it. And I think I'm going to try to have a custom air filter built before I go. But hey, it runs great. I think this thing has a cam and it is insanely powerful. The overlay sprocket is 60 teeth, so it has so much torque, it's unbelievable. But if you try to take it on the road, you'll feel like you're stuck in second and fourth gear. You can barely, I don't know, you might be able to go 30 miles an hour. But this thing is a beast. I love it, and I'm really glad I built it. Thanks for watching, everybody.